so welcome to you. And if this is your first night, please know that HCAM is taping all of the sessions. Thank you, HCAM. So you can have access to whatever you might have missed. There are handouts at the back, different color for each night, so you can pick those up. And I see others who are about to graduate, you know, 4 out of 4 are getting close, so let me motivate you to come back. It's really very exciting for Lauren and I, and so wonderful, such great feedback for us when you keep coming back. I know how hard it is to carve out time. So as I was driving home last week after our second session, I'm talking to my daughter, who was the one with the Robert Munsch story with the boy in the drawer. And she was like, oh, Mom, you know, I remember that book. But I was sharing some of your stories with her. And she just, it was so much fun to be able to say, oh, and then this parent said this happened. And so I want to start with that, because I think that's such a fun way to start our time together. Anybody have any experiences that you had with your children or child trying a new strategy in this past week that you'd like to share? And now she's in the front row.
Yeah, she was very right uncomfortable there.
She's much more comfortable. You know what, it doesn't have to be necessarily the strategies that we tried last week, but just even an experience that you had that you'd like to share.
I use the move on strategy,
yes,
and that helps a lot, especially since my daughter, she's in first grade, and she's been choosing some books that are perhaps beyond her ability, and they don't have the pictures to help her. Mm-hmm. And I was struggling with what to try to get her to do it herself, and the move on seemed to help.
That's
I
great.
Say, you know, skip that word and go back. You know, what do you think makes sense there? And just in general, this whole thing has given me such a different perspective. And my daughter goes for extra help for fluency. And I feel like part of why she was stopping and having trouble with the fluency was because my husband and I both would say, oh, no, that one's wrong, that was wrong, go back, that was wrong. And we completely changed our strategy. So I'm hopeful that will really help her.
You know, and thank you for saying that, because we're all here because we want to do the best for our kids. And when you don't have the tools to know what should I do, you're doing the best you can do. But I also feel a sense of taking a little bit of weight off your shoulders of, okay, I can relax a little bit about this reading thing because it's going to be okay. And when you relax a little bit about it, so do your kids. So thanks for sharing that. I know you had one as well that you were going to share.
Yeah, it was funny. I was using the nudge,
yes,
technique, and I knew my daughter, so I was doing it with my oldest, she's in first grade, and I would nudge her, and she'd read like one word, and then she'd nudge me back. And then I'd read a few like sentences, and then I'd nudge her, she'd read like 2 words, and I'm like, this is not going to work. But as I kept doing it, and I would like give her, not say, don't nudge me back.
Yeah.
But we did it, and then after a while, she would like read like pages, and then finally she was like, nudging me back. So it did work. I was worried that it wasn't going to work.
So what do you think was going on there?
I think she just, sometimes she's tired and she's lazy.
Yeah.
And I know she knows all the words, because I was nudging her at proper times where I knew she knew the words, but she just wanted me to read, which, again, it's okay.
So this, you're right on. The other thing that happens with nudge that you might not think about, because you were describing, I'm assuming, the beginning of the story. Mm-hmm. The other thing that happens is as you do nudge, you're giving your child background knowledge. So they're getting the sense of what this story's about, and that helps them with being able to read the rest of the text. And so often we give a child a brand new book, they have no background. We might not have done a picture walk or any kind of discussion about the before prompts that we gave you to talk about getting some ideas about what we're bringing to the text. And I think we do that too as adult learners. When you think about, you know, whether you're at a book club or not, when you open a brand new novel, it takes, right? You love those books where it draws you in the first few pages, because otherwise that first chapter can be really, oh, you know, I want to get into this book. And it's the same thing with nudge, because you're taking the work away from it, but you're giving her a sense of the story that, oh, okay, now I'm into this. This is kind of cool. Mm-hmm. And then they can run with it and just nudge you when they get to that tricky word. So thank you for that one. And we're going to talk about fluency tonight, too, give you some specific fluency strategies. So
And you know, we have an example. Do you remember we couldn't just put our hands on a great example of a context clue, the Move On, that you used with your child? So here's a Henry and Mudge book. Many of you are familiar with Henry and Mudge. So here's a sentence. Henry's father, the car horn. You know, a child might not necessarily know the word honked initially, but making sense, what do you do with a car horn? Honk, does that make sense? But moving on and not trying to sound it out with that NK would be a little difficult for a developing reader, but the rest of the sentence, that context clue.
The car horn.
Mm-hmm. Then they can come back. You know what they do? They honk the car horn.
Mm-hmm. And did she feel like...
Not a picture to help me here this time. So that's part of the move-on strategy.
Right, that was what I was struggling with.
Yeah, there's not a car here.
Right.
Did you get a sense of when she read it the second time, she felt really good about that, when she got it on her own?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what this is all about. Let me pause. Any others? Any other situations or stories you can tell us, experiences with your children? And maybe it'll come as we go through the evening. So this is what we call wait time. Just wait. It's hard for Lauren and I, but we're doing it. Okay. So that brings us to exactly where I actually gave you a copy this time. Just the reminder of what we're talking about here is our goal is to give just enough help as children try new skills and become increasingly independent. So just enough help. We want them, as we say, to problem solve the words. And we're going to talk to you tonight about the five finger rule, because you want the text, the book, to be just right, tricky enough that they're making some mistakes so that they can problem solve the words, but not so difficult that it's taking away the meaning and the enjoyment of the story. And then sometimes we want a book that's actually easy so that they're not making mistakes so we can practice fluency. So we're going to talk a lot about level of book and how you would use it, and how we want sometimes those super easy books, but if we want them to be trying our strategies, then we would want a book where they're sometimes getting stuck. So just enough help. And assisting your child, I just said that part. So, and then the wait time that we just talked about, Lauren described it last time where you can see the wheels moving. So allowing, once you've practiced a strategy with them, like move on, you could try observing your child when they get stuck. Don't say anything, don't prompt them. See if they apply move on, and then really praise them for that. That's when you use that language. I saw that you moved on and came back and tried it again. That's what good readers do. And so you're noticing, you're really reinforcing that in them, because the goal of all of this is to have kids independently apply the strategies we're talking about. So they don't need a guide on the side to give them some strategies that work for them that they can try independently when they're reading without you or without their teacher. What we don't want them to do is the two things that kids who struggle do, and that is, leave it out, just skip it, or just guess and not care if it made sense. Those are the two things we don't want them to do. Okay, so having them independently apply a strategy and you see them working through the word is really great. So stopping long enough to see if they're going to look at the picture. You know, am I going to check out the picture and then come back to the word and you see them doing that? Did you want to add anything to the overview piece, or did you want to go right into the overview connection?
Well, I think what's wonderful is now that you have strategies and each week you're building your repertoire of strategies, you're also able to support a variety of strategies at home, so you can provide the wait time, you know when to point out the picture, you know when to move on, because now as you're learning, there are different strategies that best match different situations, stories, print, whatever the context may be, and I think you're feeling a little empowered on yourselves now that you just have that much more information on how to support your reader. With what you said, I think so many parents have that. You are trying to support your child in the development of reading, but you're thinking back and you remember, sound it out. You know, that's what lingers in your mind, not all the other strategies. So I think it's kudos for sharing that, and we'll have this information on the website after for those parents that weren't able to attend, because there are so many good strategies, and you can use them with developing readers, you can use them with struggling readers, you can use them with readers as they get older, because as books are introduced that are more challenging, children are going to encounter difficulty. So sometimes when children are in, you know, past center school, they still have challenges, and these strategies still work for them. Just because they're in second grade or beyond doesn't mean they don't need these supports, because now they're reading much more challenging texts. They're reading with a different purpose, perhaps to find out some added information, more so, whereas at center, we might just be working on understanding what the print is on the page. Now they've got a little bit more with it. So save these and even use them with your older children.
Great point. Really good point to make. And tonight we are going to talk about sound it out and when to use it appropriately. So it is a valid strategy. We just wanted to give you some others first.
Mm-hmm. So Lauren, do you want to talk about this next piece, which is,
sure,
we've alluded to it once before already, but it's the idea about making connections. Mm-hmm.
So if you have some stories, I'm just going to choose some. So the first one is connecting to life experiences. So when you're talking and you're using a think aloud, think of yourself as the narrator. You're talking about what you see. You're relating it to your own experience. You're helping build background knowledge and preparing your child to read. Oh, if you take a mouse to school, you know, I go to school, you go to school, I wonder what will happen here. What are some things that happened with you at school? You're talking about different experiences throughout the day. You're talking about different specials you might have. Sort of preparing to read, and we're not even opening up the book yet. We have a lot to add to that conversation because we're in school a lot, so we know a lot about that. And that sort of builds your confidence as well. Even though I might not have read this book, I know about school, so I feel like I might know some good things about this story. Then you would be able to take your picture walk, look at what's happening there, and talk about getting ready for school. So here's an example of bringing that to a life experience. Another example was a
other books.
Oh, Goodnight Goon. This reminds me of a book that we always read. Do you remember that? Oh yes, Goodnight Moon. What happened in that story? Talk about the story. What you're doing is you're actually recalling the story. You're not summarizing, you're just recalling. You have your events in order, a retelling, very basic. I wonder what will happen here, if it will be the same, if it will be different. So now you're doing maybe a little compare and contrasting. Okay, let's read and find out. You've piqued their interest, you've related it to something that's familiar and comfortable to them, but you know what, there's a new twist here, because Goodnight Goon, oh my, that sounds a little silly too. So you're building that excitement.
And if it's a series,
yeah,
this is a great way to start talking about characters. So, you know, we can make a connection because we can expect that every book that we read in this series are going to have those main characters, Henry and Mudge, and then you can talk about that a little bit. One, you know, remember what happened the last time, and oh, wasn't that silly, and a little bit of problem solution. Have you noticed that every time Henry and Mudge, they get into trouble over something, and how do they solve those problems? So you're, again, making those connections to another book that already builds for them the idea of character development. And then the other one is the world events.
The world events. There are early readers that have to do with world events, such as weather-related events. You've got, here's one, fire, fire, said Mrs. McGuire. You know, our fire departments, you know, helps keep us safe. Children recognize them from practicing fire drills.
There was just a fire in town on the weekend, right?
Okay.
The kids might have been talking about or might have been worried about. So just making a connection to something that's happening in town or something that's happening internationally or even, you know, in the city last week with the terrible fire that took place. So setting some context for making connections helps with comprehension.
And also with young children, it can help address emotions. Children have a lot of emotions about different situations. You know, perhaps not as much about Goodnight Goon and Goodnight Moon, but here you go about fire, fire, when you talk about, you know, what's happening here in relations to people. And it's nice to be able to discuss that in the context of a story, because it's okay to feel that way. Sometimes you will feel a little nervous about things and scared, perhaps, and worried. And then that can build to a conversation of what you do to help prepare and be safe for things.
Yeah. And so the connection for all, the reason for all of these making connections is to build comprehension and to give your child the message that we read for information. There's a message. And whether it be, whether we're talking about narrative text or whether we're talking about nonfiction text, there's still a message. In a story, it's the message is the story. But in nonfiction, they're getting information. So we want to give the message all the time. And I want to say it's particularly important for beginning readers because they don't necessarily know that. They might think that reading is about figuring out the way print works, and I see people nodding their heads. And initially it is, I want to say more for those very beginning, preschool, early kindergarten. We just need to figure out that those letters, and there's a space between those letters that are grouped together, and that's called a word. So establishing the concept of word is a very beginning step to reading. Once we get past that, and that there's breaks, and that there's those things at the ends of the sentence that are punctuation marks, and that's all part of what concepts of print that we teach kids early on. But once we get beyond concept of print, we want to make sure that kids understand that the most important thing about reading is that there's either a story or a message, and it's all about comprehension. So these kinds of connections help to provide that message, and you can do it during the reading. And when we say think aloud, you know, if you think of something as you're reading with your child, it's great to model that. Wow, that just made me think of, remember when we were on vacation last summer and we saw such and such, right? So you're modeling that think aloud again when your child does, and it's fantastic when they're reading with you and then all of a sudden they stop and they say, you know, they make a connection to what they've just read. Our first reaction is sometimes to keep them back on the text, right? Oh, wait a minute, you know, that's not what we're talking about, get back to, but it's really actually very important that you do that when they want to make a connection and stop what they're doing right there, to follow their lead and let them go off text and have a little bit of a sidebar conversation and then pull them back in. You're nodding your head, so I know that you know that's it's not just about getting through it. And if you end up having a lovely conversation about something that you're reading, you know what? You can pick it up tomorrow night. There's no rule that you have to get through that. The important thing is that you're spending time together reading every night. Whether or not you get through the number of pages is less important.
So a great way would be, this reminds me of, oh, I wonder, do you remember? So for your child who might not be making those connections independently, you can help facilitate that. But you're posing it in a non-threatening manner where you're not quizzing them as you're going along. Now, what do you notice about this?
That's a great
book. Or what's going on here in the story. And maybe they'll have, I don't know. They might have a hard time putting their finger on what you're thinking of because that trip that you took was so memorable and so whatnot, but they took something else out of that trip. They might need a little support to help scaffold that thinking to get there. But yeah, those are great. You know, I wonder, I notice, what do you think? Questions there.
Questions, comments, anything you want to add before we move on to tonight's strategies? So we're going to begin, and I think it would be good to do our five ones together. Can we do sliders and sound it out together? Not together, but you could after each other.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So some sliders.
And start with
sliders.
You can
use so many things for sliders. So these are fly swatters with a little pocket, little window cut out. So you can follow along. So in my window is what I'm reading. If you take a mouse to school. It helps with tracking, helps me facilitate one-to-one correspondence, and I'm following along the print. So teachers will use them in their class. They'll swap words, they'll look for letters. Might be a little bit much to use at home. So there are some others.
Or let's admit some others. So the other way to be using this is to just isolate some sounds. Okay, so if they are stuck on a word, and we're going to talk about sound it out tonight, as I've said before, but you want to make sure that, first of all, it's sounded outable, right? Before you use that strategy, make sure it can actually happen. So we're not going to sound out S-C-H, no way, but we could sound out O-O-L. What sound does that make? And then add a beginning letter, like P, for, so then they can put those two together and say the word pool. And then you could use a context and say, so, you know, what do you, and then they're just going to go to the SC, right? So taking a word apart is what sliders is good for, so that you can help them to decode the part that is decodable
or the part that you know they're going to know. If they're not working on double vowels, you're not gonna go there. But if you know that they know CVCs, so consonant, vowel, consonant combinations like cat, bat, rat, you know they can do that well and they can do it with short A, then you're gonna just isolate that on the page. So in this case, I might isolate the word knowing that they've been working on long vowels and I know that they know this, and this is decodable because it actually works in this case, then I would use it. I could say, you want to try sounding this out, but I've isolated it now away from the text and it can make it easier for them to decode.
So there are other ways. I'll use the same story. You could take a pipe cleaner, then the pipe cleaner. You could move that along to highlight words or word parts. Sometimes sliders are short, sometimes they're long. You can move it along as you're reading. For the child, instead of word by word, you can do line by line. And there's also a way to make sliders at home. You just, piece of paper, all you do is fold it, cut out a little rectangle inside, and you've got a really neat window. You could use, let's see, an index card that's a little thicker, and you can slide that along. So there's so many different ways to move it along and isolate words, sentences, and when the print is smaller, you might have a few sentences at a time that you're able to identify. So depending on where your child is and the shape and the purpose, there's many ways to use these, but it does help track, move along, isolate, again, that phonics aspect that you might be looking for, or even if you're reading in sections and chunks, it doesn't always end that your sentence at the end of a line as children are reading, and once they have they're working on attending to that, you can read for a certain section and then stop and talk about it. Mm-hmm. So if we were to look at, how many, does anyone ever use anything like this at home? Some of you do, some of you maybe. You might use your finger a lot, but this just adds a little something extra to it. They don't have to be a fancy fly swatter, but anything will work.
And remember whose finger it should be, right? One of you graduates who's been here every night, come on now, whose finger should it be?
Theirs,
right? So we are always just so tempted to, and I actually saw a teacher do this just last week, so it's we all do it, where, you know, they make a mistake and we're very quick to point back to that word to say, well, they, and we talked about this, they know it, they know there was something not quite right, so you're going to use that prompt. Something didn't sound quite right there, and they're going to go back and they're going to point to it. And if appropriate, you can say, let's try sounding it out, or do you want to try sounding it out? But again, it's appropriate if you know it will work, right? So it's not going to be the word laugh, for sure. So then they would be at the word because they know where it didn't sound quite right. They've gone back, they're pointing to it with their finger, and they're going to, you know, work through that word with their little finger. Okay, so that's just so important. Erin.
I thought I would say, because I know fun fly sweaters are hard to find, it happened to me in Hopkinton Lumber the other day, and they have a whole selection of kid fun fly sweaters.
Wow.
If anybody wants a fly sweater.
There you go. Could you make that plug again for Hopkinton Lumber? Thank you very much. Erin Graziano.
She's on the book fair.
Yeah, they have the pointers at the book fair. Those always go.
Yeah. And this is not the best activity, obviously, to do in bed, but if it's right. The weekend or if it's after school and you're at a table reading instead of in bed, that would be something.
Not where you might want the smaller ones to move along.
Yeah.
Would the idea be that they're holding the slider or you are? Because I feel like it might be too much. They would be.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's why lots of hands are moving around. Holding the book.
So that's why I say you want to be at a table.
With the book in your lap.
Yeah.
Okay. If you're sitting with the book and you've got the slider nearby, you won't necessarily be using it for every word, but it's there to pull up.
Yeah. Okay.
To help isolate the word.
Okay.
Okay. So we're going to demonstrate now. You pulled out a few books for lines.
Yes.
We did that one, and then we had this one.
Okay. So we're reading here. We're on the page with them. We're going to talk about now when we would say, sound it out here. Do you want to be the reader?
Okay. Unfortunately, it's the second word. So
That's someone climbing a mountain. We call that person a mountaineer. I would not have her try to sound out mountaineer. She didn't know it, but to try to sound out that word.
And the picture's not going to help me. That doesn't even look like a mountain, because the guy's bigger than the mountain, right? So I'm not going to say look at the picture. And I'm really not going to be familiar with the word mountaineer, even if the picture did support it. So what we're demonstrating tonight is that, you know, you're the expert now, so you're always going to use a strategy that actually is going to work. You're not going to use a strategy that when you look ahead to either the word or the picture, your child's going to be able to figure it out from your prompt. So Lauren did the exact right thing. She just told me what it was. She just was not going to, you know, waste time having
or
me.
Or have her try to guess what a mountaineer was.
Doesn't really matter. Right? So she just told me that's a mountaineer. That's what that person is. Mm-hmm. So then she would probably start me again.
Yeah, let's start again.
The mountaineer has lost his map. What a.
Let's see. I think we could sound this out. What sound does that better make?
Let's
put it together.
Mess. What a mess.
Nice.
What a mud. Mud.
First part of that word is
so
mud.
So she's now
nice
she's
job.
Using her slider.
Yep, so I covered up the end of the word. The word is muddle. Mud. And I know she doesn't yet have the D-L-E. She has the first part mud, and I'm going to add the rest of the word muddle. Muddle. You try.
What a muddle. Yes, so she took off, she reinforced the part that I got right, which is always the best thing to do. Wow, you're so close. You got almost the whole word. And so I got mud. So she just very simply covered up the part I didn't get so I could see mud in isolation. And then she moved her finger along and slowly, but she would use, sorry, she didn't use a slider, slowly slid it along so that it sort of revealed the rest of the letters, and then she said it at the same time. So she's supporting me through sound it out, but appropriately so, knowing that I didn't know DL, reinforcing the part I did know. Okay? And then, oh, where is his mom? I don't know if I would have known mom. So here's one. Let's do this one.
Okay.
Look, look, look what I can do.
Doesn't know the double vowels yet.
The words leap, leap.
So I'm looking at it, I'm assessing. We're jumping. That word is another word for jump, leap.
So then that's going to help me with the next word. So she just gave me leap, so I'm going to say leap high, lie low, lick a large.
And I'll cover up the end of the word, but her eye already went to the picture because she knew that was there. Yes.
Yeah. So this multiple supports here. So one mountaineer, just give it to them. Support the part that they know. We're not saying sound it out unless we know that it's clearly decodable and it's within our child's ability. So we're not going to say sound out a double vowel word. We're not going to say sound out leap because they haven't learned that word yet. And you can't, unless you know the rule, you're not going to be able to sound out a double vowel word.
When we added a little vocabulary, oh, that's another word for jump. It's leap, because maybe she wasn't familiar with that word, leap.
So here's a good one. So no, 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 this isn't Nike. Nike.
Now,
the word's Nike.
She's just started to work on the E at the end, which makes the vowel say its name sometimes. Teachers will call it Magic E, King Ed. I noticed there's the E at the end of that word. And remember you told me what you were learning about what E does when it's at the end of the word?
I, nigh.
She's got that, and I'm going to tell her the rest of the word because the C is not making that. That's the beginning, you're right, nice. She might not know that soft C sound there for the S, but she's got the nigh at the beginning, nice. Try that again.
No, 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 this isn't. Nice. Here is a ninny I don't like this book, everybody. But it reminded me of her daughters with the washing machine. Machine, because she was applying the rule the best that she knew. So this is, in other words, we wouldn't use sound it out for a word like nice. It just doesn't follow the rules. It's not going to make sense for you to use that prompt. But you could certainly use it for the word nut. There's also a picture, but, you know, I might not know that that's a nut necessarily, unless I was familiar enough with walnuts. So I might not know that's a nut, and I might be struggling for the word, but clearly you know that nut is one that's easily decodable. And that would be a good one to use to say, sound it out. Or a multisyllabic CBC word would be good. So where you have multiple,
like lollipop.
Lollipop would have been a good one. Yeah. And I could lollipop, yes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. So, questions about when do you sound it out? The most important piece that we wanted to demonstrate tonight is that parts of it can be useful, but be very careful when you use it that the word is actually decodable and that your child has, you know from what's been coming home, that they've been exposed to whatever rule it is that's guiding that particular choice. And then use it sparingly, because there's so many other wonderful strategies that work just as well as sound out.
And many of the sight words that your child will practice, the high frequency words, do not follow the rules and they can't be sounded out. So you cannot try to sound out the, said, have, all of those rule breakers, those oddball rules. So if your child's having difficulty with a word like that and they try to make an attempt, you could supply that word, because to have them try to labor context clues and going to help with a word of that manner, sounding it out, a picture. So those are the sight words, because it's best to help learn those by sight so you're able to apply. Because these strategies just are very difficult for those.
But the other thing Lauren did that I know you noticed that she did, she had me go back and try it again. She would say, try it again, or she would say, you try. And the reason that's really important is that the more that the child says the actual word themselves, looks at it, there's a connection between I'm looking at the word, I'm saying the word, the more they do that in the context of the text, the more quickly that word becomes a sight word. And it becomes a sight word just as easily as it would if you were drilling them on the words in isolation. So we know that they can learn it that way, but they can also learn it by seeing it repeatedly in text. That's why they learn thus so quickly, because it's in so many sentences. It appears so often, and so they see it. It quickly becomes part of their sight word vocabulary. So that's another way. She made me go back, read it again, and that's why the fluency rereads that we're going to talk about tonight are also important for building sight word vocabulary.
So let's just transition to the you read, I read.
Okay.
That sound good? Some old favorites. This is a book near and dear. My sister had it and it was passed on to me. So this would be an I read, you read. And it's great for expression. So we have a variety of books to share. Short books, long books, nonfiction books as well here. So old hat, new hat.
Old hat, new hat.
So now I would probably share this together here. Or we're reading, or I could just kind of hold it there. Old hat, new hat.
Old hat, new hat.
See, with a book that is simple like this, you're able to express your voice, have the prosody, the expression there. Too big. Too small.
Too big. Too small.
Okay, here we go. Too beady, too bumpy, too leafy, too lumpy.
So now, because there was so much on that page, she's just doing the one page. Too beady, too bumpy, too leafy, too lumpy.
Too twisty, too twirly, too wrinkly, too curly.
Okay, so you get it. So you're wondering, what is that doing for your reader? For one thing, I'm going to know the word too. T-O-O, I just saw it a million times. That's in my sight word vocabulary now. I'm learning expression. So the picture with the hat that was too big and the hat that was too small, I'm learning the prosody, which brings meaning to the text. And I would not necessarily have done that if I was just focusing on trying to figure out what those words were. So it gives me the opportunity to do that. Plus, it's just fun to do that together, and it takes away any pressure. this was a great idea. Lauren brought this tonight. What a fun thing to do with a riddle book, a book of riddles.
Especially for the readers that are a little reluctant. They love facts. They love to hear interesting, neat, weird, cool things here.
But it's beyond their reading level.
A bat can eat 3,000 insects in one night.
Wow.
I know.
So she's bringing me back into the text, and I'm using my finger. I'm putting myself back in. A bat can eat, and I wouldn't maybe know what 3,000, I might not know what that number is. 3,000 insects in one night.
Let's see if we found some. Gorillas burp when they're happy.
And you gotta see the picture. You see the black font? So it's just fun, you know, and I'm having fun, and gorillas burp when they're happy.
So this is a book that you don't have to necessarily read cover to cover. You could flip through, find something interesting, and especially for those children that love nonfiction books, the books about the solar system from the library, and you're thinking, how do you read aloud a book like this? You could read components of it, captions, phrases. And here's one. Slugs have 3,000 teeth and 4 noses.
So that's just
I mean, yeah. But what a great way, your nonfiction book, you're building up some information here. You're able to change your voice with expression, because I might think they're just yucky by the sound of my voice. And the gorilla's burp, you know that they would just be all over. And you might have some practice.
Oh, and you know what? I'm going to go back into this book, aren't I? I'm going to know that page now. I'm going to remember it. I'm going to reread it. I'm going to read it to my friends. Did you know all those blogs? But I'm really excited now. I'm bringing a book, sharing it with my friends, reading it to them. So there's all sorts of results that come from that kind of thing.
So we had a simple text to practice reading, some interesting facts. Now we've got a more challenging text.
So now we have a text that we really want to enjoy, you read then I read, with a book that has wonderful vocabulary, a beautiful flow. And Charlotte Zolotow is one author who provides just really rich. This would be typically a read aloud. This would typically be something you would read aloud to your child. But you can use you read, then I read, with something like that, this, and develop some phrasing.
Mm-hmm. Now his mother came to say goodnight. Why does the day have to end? He asked her. So night can't begin, she said. Look. I wouldn't read the whole page because there's a lot of print, so I would stop midway. Say, now your turn.
Now his mother came to say goodnight. Why does the day have to end? He asked her. So night can begin, she said. Look.
So she mirrored how I used my expression, so I'm modeling questions. My voice went up when
do,
I asked.
Do this sentence.
She pointed out the window where, high in the darkening sky, behind the branches of the pear tree, the little boy could see a pale sliver of moon.
She pointed out the window where, high in the darkening sky, behind the branches of the pear tree, the little boy could see a pale sliver of moon. And the pictures that I was looking at while she was reading support the sliver of moon. It lets me listen and develop some comprehension about what this is about. And it just exposes me to a beautiful text in a really enjoyable activity. So again, it's all getting at wanting to encourage your child to really love reading. And you read, then I read is a really nice way of doing it, both in a fun way that we demonstrated tonight, and then just in a more nurturing kind of, this book's beyond you. And you wouldn't necessarily, the other way to do you read, then I read, is that then I might read that whole next page, just so that they can listen in, and then do, maybe this would be a page that we would do you read, then I read on as well.
Or maybe you just read what's in the quotation marks, what's being said.
Mm-hmm.
Something that was great with the page that we just shared is I modeled how to pause when there's a comma in print, and Kathy did that. She did a nice job.
Thank
when
you.
She struggled on the word darkening, I didn't tell her or prompt her as she was looking around. So I covered up the end of the word, so it was just the beginning of the word, and slowly slid my finger.
But then once I got the dark, I remembered her saying darkening. So then I could go back there, because I'd already just heard it. So she helped me prompt me appropriately with the part that she knew I would know, and then I remembered that I could recall. Yeah, that would be a good thing to do, too, is just that you would do this part, and we would do...
Mm-hmm. So if it was helpful, I could hold under what part you'll read.
Okay.
The little boy lay in bed, and his mother sat beside him. "Where does the wind go when it stops?" he asked. "It blows away to make the trees dance somewhere else."
"Where does the wind go when it stops?"
What?
She's covered up.
Heard how your voice went up. That's what you do when you say a question. You hang your voice up on that hook. Nice job.
"It blows away to make the trees dance somewhere else."
Can you imagine wind dancing? You know, and then maybe you'd have a conversation. Because that's a neat way to describe wind, where it's dancing. So why might they liken wind to dance? So you're building some comparisons, and that's a little higher level connection. But children could certainly make that with your support. You could have a lot of fun with these great books.
So next we're going to talk about the five-finger rule. And we'll do a Jigsaw Jones mystery, the case of the frog jumping contest. So earlier I said, we didn't do jumpy piece. So we talked a little bit about, you read and I read could be a good example of a fluency. I know we did when we talked about poetry and we talked about rereading favorite books over and over and over again, but you read and I read can also be a nice way of practicing fluency, and it can be a familiar text.
Mm-hmm. Here, we could do this, I like me. This is a simple
short,
I like me.
I have a best friend. I have a best friend.
That best friend is me.
That best friend is me.
I do fun things with me. I draw beautiful pictures.
I do fun things with me. I draw beautiful pictures.
So it doesn't have to be, you know, a short, you know, phrase book. Here we have some sentences, but we're reading as we're speaking. We're not laborious over each word. So it's okay that she's copying me. She remembers what I've said. Her eyes are following along the print. If she adds an extra word, sometimes children will do that. They'll add in different things. Just take note of it and see if it's happening on each page. If it is, then I might bring in a slider or something to track as you read to help that one-to-one correspondence. Because sometimes children will hold a book and they will tell you a novel. But that's what, especially those beginning readers before they're reading, they know that this says something and they're just trying to share that meaning with you. So if you have someone who's sort of guessing and just making up a story, just bring them back, have a finger, have a slider, and maybe if this page had two sentences, maybe do one at a time and to help break it down and maybe work on some of those shorter fun stories.
This is a great strategy. It just comes to mind for your older child to do with the younger child. It's a really fun one. They enjoy it because they feel like they're helping out, and the younger one likes it because they're meeting with their older sibling. And it can be a really nice thing to do for two kids. So five-finger rule, basically you have to have a long enough text for this to work. But it can also work with a simpler book that a child is struggling through. But if we use this example, and this is a good one for if your child chooses. We talked last week about frustration over kids not making the best choices at the library at school and coming home with books that either their friends wanted to get or that really they're interested in but can't read. And that's okay too. But if it's a strategy that they try on their own, I always just say just open the book in the middle, because you don't necessarily want to use some of the other strategies that we've been talking about tonight. You just want to know whether or not this text is going to support your reader. And so they're designed that way. They're designed with certain vocabulary or certain level of decoding or comprehension. And so it's very simple. Every time they make an error, they just put up a finger. And you can do this for them initially to say, This is just a little bit too difficult. And you wouldn't stop at that night.
you get through somehow that night. But you'd know to get a different choice the next time. If it was one you were reading aloud to them, maybe you would jump in and say, you know what, I'm gonna, maybe I'll read the next page. And then give them a little bit of context or do some echo reading or some nudge. Maybe that's when you just pick up and do nudge and let them off the hook. Because if there's more than five errors on a page like this, it's way too difficult. And that's in a nutshell, basically just every time they get stuck on something. You're just really initially, like, okay, so Mila nodded, but it's possible that Adonis escaped at the time when everybody was visiting. Stringbean bit his lip. Yes, it's possible. Mila looked at me. Are you thinking what I'm thinking? So we're doing all right so far, she asked. Are you thinking that you'd love a glass of grape juice? I wondered. And it goes on. They get to, oh, I mused. So that they're not going to get mused, probably. And then we have the word interrupted. That might be a tricky one. So you'll know pretty quickly, if they're stopping every other line for a tricky word, the books are absolutely written with a certain level of reader in mind. And so if they're getting that stuck and they get to five, you just really know that that's not. Because it's the percentage, right? Within 100 words, 100 words, we want kids making five errors so that they're reading at a 95% reading rate, because that's the exact right number of errors for them to make in 100 words, for them to be able to grow. We want to challenge them a little bit. We want them to apply their problem-solving strategies when they get to tricky words so that they can improve as a reader. But we don't want it to be so tricky that it's having a negative impact on comprehension or even just enjoying the book. So when teachers work with groups of kids in their reading groups, and you've heard about them being in their guided reading group, they're assessed at that level of error, and they're grouped accordingly. So that on a level text, they're making X number of errors. So that the just right independent reading level would be 95%. Teachers would probably teach them more like at the 90 to 92% level of errors based on the assessments that they're doing in the school. So that basically is what they're doing too.
It's kind of related, but you're talking about errors, and it made me think, are we supposed to correct all errors, or are there some that you just let go?
That's a great question. There are some you just let go. Which ones would we let go? We would let go errors that don't impact on meaning, and we would let go errors that, for example, I used the example during one of our nights about a child's name, right? If they're mispronouncing the name of the child, we're gonna let that go. It doesn't matter. If they say cat for kitten,
or like sit sat,
yeah,
you know, he'll say sat if, right. Mean, he knows both words, but sometimes it's just in his brain.
Okay,
and he'll just say, you know, he sit on the chair.
Okay, so then what you're going to say there is something didn't sound quite right, because now it's grammatically incorrect. We don't want to take them to the decoding part on that particular error, because that's not what it's about. It's about, that didn't sound quite right. And they'll go back and they'll fix it.
Right.
They will, because they'll know, just that didn't sound right, because I know that it should have been set. And what you're getting at there is you're getting the child away from word by word reading. Now I'm thinking about, what does that mean in the context of this sentence? That didn't sound quite right. And you use that prompt, which you can pick up from, I think it was week two when we said that one.
And sometimes you'll need to repeat the phrase that they said. So they were so busy focused on pulling the print from the page.
Yeah.
You could say, this is what I heard, what you read, and repeat exactly what they said. Did that
you
sound
said.
Right?
Yeah.
Exactly. So instead of pointing out that one word, try to put it in the phrase or the sentence that, especially when it's a grammatical error, chances are they will realize, oh, yeah.
Right. So if it's grammatical or comprehension, then that's exactly what you could do. And when you say it like that, you know what? You said da-da-da, and you reread it. They're going to fix it right away.
Right.
And you could ask them to show you where it is in the
And that's the thing. I know he can fix it. I mean, I know he can fix it. So sometimes I think, well, should I draw attention to the fact that he said it wrong, or should I just let it go? Because I know that he knows.
I think when it changes the meaning of the story and the grammatical.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Because what the goal is to have him monitoring his own reading and going back to those. So you don't want to make it so much so that your example at the beginning was, you know, every time they made a mistake, we're stopping them. What's important, and this is probably a better answer to your question, don't correct them until they're finished the sentence.
Right.
Let them finish the sentence. What you're leading them towards is self-correcting, and it will come pretty quickly. But they're not used to you letting them finish the sentence. They're used to you jumping in right away whenever there's an error.
That didn't sound right, because for stuff like that,
yeah,
when you know that they know.
Yeah. But let them finish the sentence and then say, something didn't quite sound right there.
And then you're having them problem solve. You're not telling them right. This is what that word is. Right. Because again, if they're completing that problem solving process, soon they'll own it.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
I have to bring this up just because that just totally reminded me that we had read the story, Edwina, the dinosaur who didn't know she was extinct, or what, it's a really long title, but it's a Mo Willems book. But we had read it to our girls 1,000 times, but she had never, my kindergartner had never read it to us. So it was on the list, or my list, or some list, and so we were reading it, she was reading it to me at night, and she, the first time she got to Edwina, she said Edwina, and I was like, how many times have we heard? And I stopped myself because I'm like, oh my God, what are you doing? It's a name. She doesn't know the difference. So I stopped myself and I just sat there and listened. And she got through like three more pages, whatever, and then Edwina. And I'm like, seriously? You wouldn't remember that it's Edwina? We've read it 1,000 times. In my head. I didn't say it out loud.
Good girl.
And then we get all the way, you know how much restraint that took for me. So then we get to the end of the book and she looks at me and she was like, it's not Edwina, the dinosaur. And I said, oh, it's not? And she's like, you know that. And I said, oh, I don't know. I don't remember. You can pronounce it different. I was like so caught off guard by her correcting herself. And she said, how many times did you just let me say Edwina?
Yeah.
And I said, well, it doesn't matter, Casey. It's a name. It doesn't make a difference. You got the whole story. You read really nicely. I mean, I was supporting her with the whole, that's what good people do, like the whole way through. And we did really well. And she said, I can't believe all the times I heard that book, I said Edwina the whole time. And I didn't even realize it till the end that I was wrong. And I said, did it matter? It was
the
same story.
But the fact that she realized, you know, and made that connection, that's when I would say that's what good readers do.
Yeah.
You know, you realize now, you let her take the opportunity.
Right. Right.
Granted, not all children would do that with a name, especially with things such as that.
Right.
But the fact that she realized and made that connection, that's significant.
It also tells me that she's still really tied to the print. So she actually decoded it accurately.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right? So she applied what she knows is her most powerful strategy still, which is what should it sound like? And that was stronger than what she had in her listening vocabulary from hearing it over and over again.
Yeah.
Which is something to work on,
mm-hmm.
because you want to pull her away from that.
Mm-hmm.
She, in the end, got it, but that was so powerful that even though the Edwina, it's not the way it looks,
right?
So that's good for you. Yeah,
well,
it's not what she's.
That's right. Very interesting. I mean, because even I think in the beginning, before I started coming to this series, I thought, oh, she's doing great. She's reading. She's ahead, because I didn't expect her even to be reading as well as she is.
Yeah.
And then when you start to really pull it apart and look at the way that she's reading, you realize, she is doing great. But there are things that if we apply these strategies, she could be doing.
And you know, not to single anybody out at all, but often kids who learn to read really easily and really quickly hit the wall in second grade. Or in third grade, because all of a sudden those things that they've been using don't work consistently anymore. And so getting, and it is those kids that just take off, and it because they've been read to a lot, they've got the sense of story, they've got concepts of print, they have phonemic awareness, everything is in place. But they haven't had to apply some of the strategic comprehension pieces to it. They rely too much on the sounds. And so, developing the strategies that kids who struggle a little bit at the beginning develop sometimes pass by the kids who take off.
And then when they encounter those difficulties, they don't know how to handle it because everything was so easy for them.
Yeah.
And that just adds to their sense of frustration. So when I mentioned earlier, these are great strategies for every developing reader, be it a center school, Elmwood, even Hopkins, that's important to note, because when children first encounter difficulty and they're not familiar with it, it's often a challenge for them for how to handle and problem solve. Mm-hmm. So they still need your support even when they're a little older.
So, questions about tonight, about other strategies that we've been talking about other weeks, that sometimes you get home and you try them out and it didn't quite make sense. Yes,
thanks. Do you always have to, is your philosophy always having them hold the book?
Okay, my philosophy is either they hold the book or you share the book.
Okay.
Right, because if it's a shared experience, if we're nudging, or if we're doing you read and I read, we can absolutely share the book. But what we don't like to see is the parent holding the book. Well, I would be probably on this side of you, holding the book, and here's the child passively, right, and I'm pointing. We don't want to see that.
Okay.
The other thing about handing the child a book is it's a really powerful gesture.
Like, I'm supposed to do something.
Oh, I totally agree.
Confidence, yeah. I have confidence in you, right? I'm going to be your guide here and support you in the reading of this book, but man, do I ever know that you're a reader.
Even at 4.
Yes.
So yes. That's when you got some of the
board
books are great. Even, you know, these aren't just for infants and toddlers. These are meant to be durable so that you can handle them.
Oh, yeah.
And to have children handle, to know, we talked a little bit about print concepts. How do you hold the book? What's the front? What's the back? The title's there. Oh, that's the person that wrote the book. Have them become familiar with turning. Even taking for granted that how we turn the pages in the progression. Some children need a little support with that at school, but that they will learn by handling books.
May I?
Yes.
Great example. Look what happens here. Now right away I'm confused, because what I was going to say is that even a young child will learn the progression by looking at the illustrations. So right away I'm going to want to do this, right? But then I'm going to go like this, and now, so, you know, I think that that's really important to the book handling piece, mm-hmm. and the turning of the pages, and even just a child. Did I tell you the story? No, I don't think I did. So I was supporting, there was a special education program happening in the building where I was a principal one summer, and there were a group of children sitting on the carpet, and they were sitting with their books, and they were, you know, looking at the pictures, and they were following the story, and I knelt down beside this little boy, and I said, "What are you reading?" And he looked at me and said, "Oh, I can't read." And so, you know, I just said back to him, "Of course, that's what good readers do. You know, you're reading the pictures. You're reading the pictures," were the words that I used. "You are reading the pictures, and that's the first step to becoming a reader." And so absolutely handling the book, reading the pictures, telling you the story that's taking place in these pictures sequentially, huge. So what are you thinking? Because there would be times, would be a time when maybe your child wouldn't read the book, hold the book.
Yeah, we read together a lot. I was just curious.
Yeah.
I was just, your
so if you're being a reader, and it's a totally a read aloud, and it's bedtime, and they're comfortable in bed, and you're reading the story, and you're not expecting them, other than maybe talking about it, you would absolutely hold the book. Because now you're the reader, and you know, maybe you're holding the book, reading the story, and showing them the pictures the way the teacher would do in a read aloud in the classroom. Yeah. What else?
I find sometimes having the child hold the book keeps the child from jumping on the bed or going on the bed, you know, because we have three in our house and two are twins. And a lot of times I'll sit between them and turn the pages, and one of them will be bored and doesn't want that book, and so she'll be wandering around the room or, you know, jumping off chairs and climbing around furniture and stuff. Mm-hmm. So
helps focus that.
Can turn the page for a few pages, and
yeah,
it helps with that a little bit for us.
And thank you for when you talked about a few pages. It's also nice, particularly if you're in the middle of a book, a longer book that you didn't get through, to start your reading together a few pages back. Or even if you're in a chapter book. So just, you know, having a little bit of a conversation about what happened in the last chapter. But rereading the last few pages of wherever you left off is a nice place to start. And you could do it as a you read, I read. Let's just reread these past the last three pages together so we remember where we left off. And you do it as a fluency piece and read it together. Or you can also choral read.
when you're reading simultaneously. So we showed you read and I read, but another nice way of reading together is to just simultaneously read the text with the, so we also call it, no, that's not echo read. We basically it's choral read, but I don't know if we're doing it next week, but basically it is filling in the text where your child gets stuck. So if we're reading together and I get stuck, what's really nice about choral read is, ready?
Yes.
Where does the rain go when the storm is over? Into clouds to make other storms. And where do clouds go when they move across the sky? To make shade somewhere else. So what happens is, when your child gets stuck, if you're reading chorally, you just keep going. Mm. And what's nice about this is if they're finger pointing, they won't lose their place. So you keep going, they hear the word in their ear, they don't have to stop to problem solve that word because we're using choral read tonight, and we're just going to keep reading together. And eventually, just like you found with Nudge, eventually the parent's voice can fade a little bit, so the child's voice is stronger as you do this strategy. I think we have that on for next week because I really like that strategy.
Sneak peek. Can you use that with more than one child at
yes.
a time? And does it matter if one of them is making mistakes
it
while
doesn't.
They're looking at
the
word?
It doesn't. Oh, such a good question. So we encourage teachers to do this strategy, actually, choral read. And at first, it's really challenging because they'll ask all of those questions. Oh, you know, but it's going to be confusing. Kids love it. I observed it in a classroom, in a third grade classroom just last week. And I walked over, and one little guy had picked himself up and left the group and went and sat on the floor. So I went over, I said, what's going on? He said, I don't have a partner today. And the other, because I don't have a partner, it's distracting me, you know, the other kids' voices. So he knew enough to take himself away from it. But what happened was there were the two reading together, and then there were two across the table reading together, and it ended up being a complete four-person choral read because they just ended up having all their voices together. But when it's done like that and a child gets stuck, the other voices carry it through and then they just pick it up and catch up on it. So it's great for comprehension, it's great for developing confidence, it's great for that sight word development because they're seeing the word, they're hearing the word, even though we're not stopping to decode it, you heard somebody else say it. So yeah, you could do it with multiple children. It's nice that there are multiple copies of the book, but you don't have to have. If someone's holding the book, it's their turn to hold the book and somebody else is.
So it's nice for the parent to help set the pace because then sometimes it's a race.
Yes.
Just like in music class, we have to learn to sing together. You need to learn to read together.
Right. Good point.
Yeah.
And that is another good thing because I don't know if we talked about this, but the idea that fluency doesn't mean that I'm the fastest reader in the classroom. And sometimes what happens when we start to measure fluency and we actually use a stopwatch because we want to know how many words they read per second, there's a benchmark that we expect. We want kids to be at a certain just right fluency level for their grade level that we know has a positive impact on comprehension. But on the other hand, if they're really competitive and they decide that the faster I can read, the better I am going to be, has a negative impact. And so we have to then model how we're going to slow them down because that's also, you know, not what good readers do. They don't read so fast that they, you know, that's not the most important thing. So it's all about providing a balance of strategies that give kids the message that reading is all about comprehension, and when we read with appropriate fluency and prosody, it adds to the comprehension of the story. And when we get stuck on words, we have a variety of ways of figuring out what that word was, and they're all very appropriate. None of them are, they're all what we do. Do you ever forget how to spell a word and you write it down and you look to see if it looks right, right? Because we're good readers and so we know what the word looks like in print. Can't remember how to spell it, two L's, one L, we write it down, we know right away, right? So those are all things that because we've seen those words as often as we have, we can use those strategies. Or have you ever gotten to an unusual vocabulary word that you've heard but you haven't seen it in print? And you see it and you're like, oh my goodness, that's how you spell that word, right? So listening vocabulary for all of us is way beyond reading vocabulary. So whether you're an adult or whether you're a child, you're going to have heard words, Wilhelmina. You're going to have heard words that you haven't seen in print.
Right.
And so that just didn't make sense to her because she hadn't seen that before. So great. Once again, thank you so much. We will do what we've always done and chat with each other. Or if you have questions, I know people want to take out books. You're welcome to. And our last session is next week. And there's a prize, right, Erin?
Yes. This nice pile of books over here.
How do you earn the prize?
Just by attending. You get a ticket.
Yeah, there you go.
They were donated by Tatnik, so shout out to them as well.
Thank you. And thank you for all the donations of snacks and treats. It's been great.